One of my most depressing and yet critically important news beats has always been the drug scene. In the past, that's meant interviews with the junkies and the pushers and the victims of the heroin epidemic. Well, tonight we report on a much different kind of drug crisis. It's one that affects everybody who ever gets sick. It's about the high cost of medicine, and we call this report the other drug crisis.
Now, you might expect to pay roughly the same price for the same drug in the same quantity from stores located in the same neighborhood, right? Well, wrong. The discount drugstore charged me $3.99 to fill a prescription for ampicillin, a price that seemed reasonable. I then picked up the identical prescription at the larger store down the block.
The pills were $9.95?
Yeah.
Ooh, sounds high. $9.95.
From $3.99, the price had jumped to $9.95. And my drug shopping tour wasn't over yet.
How much is it, by the way?
$12.
$12.
That's
right. I'm getting robbed.
That's right again.
But that incredible price differential didn't compare to what we found in the ghetto neighborhood of Bedford-Stuyvesant. There, the same 40 ampicillin capsules were selling for a high of $19.95. And when we tried to ask the pharmacist why his ampicillin was so expensive, he called the cops to throw us out of his store. What makes that sky-high ghetto price of ampicillin even more ironic is that only 3 miles across town in the middle-class neighborhood of Flatbush, the same drug sells for a citywide low of $2.80 at a chain discount store. Five wildly different prices for the same drug in the same city.
So the lesson I just learned was that nobody who's concerned about the high cost of filling a prescription should blindly accept the price quoted even in your neighborhood drugstore. Shop around. Prices vary from one drugstore to another, sometimes by as much as 1,000%. And I made another discovery I want to tell you about in this coverage of the other drug crisis. When a drug is invented, it gets two names. First, there's the official medical label. That's called its generic name. Take this drug, for instance. When Eli Lilly and company invented this painkiller, it was given the generic name proproxifene. Then the manufacturer came up with a brand name to make it easier for doctors and patients to remember it. So the generic drug proproxifene was given the brand name Darvon. And I'm sure that a lot of you out there have probably used Darvon at one time or another for headaches, toothaches, menstrual pain, that kind of thing. It's a very, very popular painkiller. Now, as with all new drugs, Lilly got a 17-year patent, during which time nobody else was allowed to make Darvon, so the price that they named for it was any price they wanted to, and today 100 capsules of Darvon 65 wholesales for $7.32, and you probably pay a lot more for that at the drugstore. But the 17-year patent on Darvon has now run out, and a number of other companies are now making the drug under its generic name of proproxifene, and they're selling it wholesale for a third of what Darvon costs. So you have two versions of the same drug. Darvon is very expensive with its famous brand name from a big company. And here you have generic proproxifene, almost unknown to the buying public, the equivalent to this drug, but it's selling for one-third the price. Now, the big drug manufacturers like Lilly claim that their brand name drugs are worth the extra money, but an awful lot of people disagree with them. And there are people like Wisconsin Senator Gaylord Nelson.
All of the studies that have been made indicate there is no difference. They are of equal quality. The Food and Drug Administration sampled 20,000 batches of antibiotics a year, and they concluded there is no difference in quality between the brand name and the generic name. So there's no reason for people to be paying 5 and 10 and 20, sometimes 30 times as much for the same drug under a brand name as it is available under a generic name.
And an HEW spokesman told Good Night America last week, and I'm quoting, "We believe any drug approved for marketing by the Food and Drug Administration meets the basic requirements for acceptable quality levels, regardless of whether it's sold as a brand or a generic."
If the only real difference, then, between brand name drugs and their generic equivalents is the price, you might ask yourself why doctors don't prescribe the cheaper generics more often and save us all some money. Well, recent hearings by the Senate Health Subcommittee concluded that the prescribing habits of many doctors are influenced by the salesmen from the major drug companies, salesmen whose job it is to push brand name drugs. In this industry, they're called detail men, and they're a special breed of salesman, part teacher and part huckster. It's the detail retail man's job, for instance, to convince the doctor that his brand is better than the competition's brand. And if all that sounds more to you like the method for selling soap or used cars, just watch as we report on what has to be the detail man's biggest annual field day, the National Convention of the American Medical Association. This year, the doctors met in Chicago, and the drug industry chose Convention Hall to show off their medicine. The crowded drug pavilion had all the color, noise, and cheesecake glamour of an auto show. All the major drug makers were there.
We've got a drug doctor known as Norfram that'll actually have your patient eating better and sleeping better in a matter of 3 to 5 days. We can send you a supply, let's say, for 15 or 20 of your new anxious depressed patients.
Senator Edward Kennedy's health subcommittee charged last March that the detail men of major drug companies actually resorted to a kind of payola to move their medicine.
Most doctors have to rely upon the detail man for, first of all, information. And our hearings indicated that the detail man only usually spends a few moments when actually seeing and talking to the doctor. Secondly, he's ill-equipped or unequipped to compare various drugs, particularly drugs between various companies. Thirdly, generally, they downplay the adverse side effects of drugs.
During the Kennedy drug hearings, a former detail man from Brooklyn testified that detail men even resorted to visiting drug stores and there studying the confidential patient prescription forms that you bring in to be filled. They did that to see if they were effectively pushing their particular products.
In order to encourage the doctor to prescribe a product, the detail man will give some sort of gift.
Buy a certain number of or a certain percentage of drugs, or a certain amount of drugs, $2,000 prior to December 31st, and get a typewriter, or get a recording machine, the kind of programs in here, for example, that show if you're able, you're a detail man and sell a certain amount of drugs, you get a color TV set. What has that got to do with meeting health needs of people that are sick and getting the right drug to them?
We screened tonight's report for Sue Kaplan of the Pharmaceutical Manufacturers Association. They represent all the major drug manufacturers. Here's her reply.
It's impossible in 1 minute to respond to all of these comments, but I'll try. Senator Nelson and Dr. Berliner know that studies have been made that do show that there's a difference between products, and that even though products may be the same chemically, they may not work the same in the body. The term is bioequivalent. They're not. And you don't have to take the industry's word for it. Senator Kennedy recently asked a panel of 10 experts to judge this issue, so let me read from Dr. Berliner's own committee report. Quote, current standards and regulatory practices do not assure bioequivalence for drug products. Why do doctors write prescriptions for brand names? Because they have heard the tablets of cheap generic versions plunk into the bedpan after having gone clear through the patient without being dissolved. They know from experience there is a difference. And, of course, there are price fluctuations between different makes of products. And there are some generics, by the way, that are more expensive than brand names. But a medicine that doesn't work is no bargain, regardless of what it's called or what its price is. Again, you don't have to take the industry's word for it. Let me quote from Dr. Richard Kraut of the FDA. He said last January, quote, physicians are not pawns of the advertising industry. I've spent too many hours of searching discussion with medical students, residents, and practicing physicians to believe that doctors are led around by journal advertising or detail men. If a physician continues to prescribe a drug over a long period of time, this reflects his satisfactory personal experience as a professional, end quote.
Ms. Kaplan's statement notwithstanding, the federal government maintains that in most cases, 85 to 90% of the time, the inexpensive generic drugs will perform at least as well as the big name brands. And the final documented fact that I want to give you tonight is that the major pharmaceutical companies, which last year recorded amongst the highest profits of any U.S. industry, spent upwards of $1 billion in just 1 year in advertising, trying to convince doctors and pharmacists that brands are better. You break that down, you break down that $1 billion figure, and it comes to an amazing $5,000 per doctor per year that the drug companies spend in hyping the brand name drugs. Now, both Senators Kennedy and Nelson have legislation pending which in effect would reduce the impact of the detail man, the drug company salesman, on the prescribing habits of doctors. It's legislation that is designed to protect the physical and economic health of all of us.